Yeah, in Belgium, we are a real football country, and I'm born in 73 now, 48 years old. And my first football memory was 1982 World Cup, and Belgium played the opening match against Argentina from Maradona, and Belgium won 1-0. And that was really my first football memory. And also in that period, I signed up with a football club. Belgium has very good youth development. In my town, were 6-7 football clubs with youth development. So I started playing on that age. I very fast went up to professional youth football, to the professional team. So that was very good. But on the other side, I knew that as a football player, I missed something to make really a big career. So I wanted to go for football, but I also had a plan B, and that attracted me already on a young age to become a football coach. And when I was in my last year of secondary school, we had to write a thesis. And I was in an economical direction, but my thesis was about football and training, a 17-year-old, 18-year-old guy. And then finished school. My dad said, you need to study. I said, yeah, I would like to try to become a professional player abroad. He said, no, you need first a degree. So, and then I said, okay, I want to study something what I can use later as a coach. So I studied psychology. And specialized in sports psychology, and I made also a thesis about professional football players' injuries, the mental part of it. So I played football in the same time. I played the third highest league in Belgium that time. I played university team, but I combined it with my study because I knew as a football player I would never achieve the highest level or financial independency. But in the meantime, I was not playing for fun. I was not studying for fun. Everything had a goal. I was doing the things to get there. And on the age of 22, 23, I went abroad and played short in the Faroe Islands. But always in my career, I had a lot of injuries. When I was 16, I had my first cruciate ligament injury, and it repeated in total 6 times. And I had also 3 times the ankle ligaments over. So I was more out of the team than in the team because of injuries, trying to come back. And by the age of 23, I said, I stop. I don't want to play on a lower level. I played at that moment the 4th highest level in Belgium. And I was again injured all the time. So I said, I stop. I started immediately my coaching course, and by the age of 25, I had my B license. But on the age of 24, I got an opportunity. I had 2 opportunities. I could play football in lower league, earn good money with that, or I could become a coach in lower league, earn less money. And I chose for the coaching opportunity, and I stopped. I was not playing coach. I was 24 and was the youngest head coach in Belgian football. I had players of 30, 35 years old in my team, and I was 24. But it was very, very good for a young guy to learn, to stand in front of a group, to develop. And now we are 25 years later. And actually, I'm not close anymore to the guy I was. But if I didn't get that opportunity at that moment of time, I would not have developed that way. In the meantime, I always combined several things. I did my study when I was 27. I had my A license already. I followed in Holland a physical coaching degree license because I never had the ambition to become a physical coach. But for me, if you are an ambitious head coach, you have to have knowledge about the physical skills, the tactical, the psychological skills, and the technical skills. And actually, you have your coaching degree, but in physical preparation, periodization, and so you can learn a lot. So that's the reason I got my degree also in physical coaching, and I had already my degree in sports psychology, so that helped a lot. So it was really always building on something, and I coached in lower leagues. I did scouting for a Premier League team. I was youth coach for a first division team in Belgium, and I combined all these things. So I was fully occupied with football. And I was trying to get into professional football as a coach, but then I got always a comment, yeah, but you are only 27, you are too young, and that was always. Now it's already thanks to Nagelsmann, Tedesco in Germany, Tuchel, these are young coaches who got the opportunity on the highest level. It opens doors for more young coaches, but when I talk in the middle 90s, yeah, everyone looked at me from, you have to play football, you can't be a coach, sure, in professional football. So I had to have the escape route to go to Faroe Islands. I played there in 1996, and in 2002, I got the opportunity to become head coach of a club there. And I was 28 years old. It was a fantastic opportunity for a 28-year-old guy to become a professional coach, to be responsible of a team in a foreign country, with several foreign professional players. So it was the right step again in my career, and it went well. And immediately, the summer season was finished. Then I was in the winter season. I got the chance to be assistant coach in Holland in the first division, what was again a new level, working with Jan Poortvliet, former national team player. Holland played World Cup final 78. So I was always busy, not thinking too much about money, but always thinking about how do I develop myself as a coach. I'm young, I want to learn, I want to become stronger and step by step on a higher level. And then I got a fantastic opportunity when I was 30 to go to Qatar. Walter Meus, the former national team coach of Belgium, former player of Ajax Amsterdam, Standard Liège, Club Brugge. I did my practicum in my coaching degree with him, and he called me and he said, hey, I need an assistant coach to go to Qatar, to the Star League. And it was the first year of the Qatar Star League in 2003, the year that Batistuta, Guardiola, Hierro, Frank Leboeuf, Khenija, all these guys, Effenberg, Basler, all these guys went to play in Qatar. And I went there as assistant coach of one of the major teams. So it was, I was 30 years old, and it was again working on a different level, working with different kind of players in a different pressure. So everything went step by step up. And naturally, by working in different countries, at that moment, I had already worked in Faroe Islands. I had did a short term in Holland and now in Qatar. People start to know you and people say, hey, this guy speaks his languages. The good thing is of being grown up in Belgium, we are a small country. My mother language is Dutch, Flemish. But we learn in school French, German, and English. So you adapt very easy in different cultures, and you can speak easier the language. So from one thing in the other, you get opportunities. And Qatar had a chance to follow a course also in skill development, Curver method, Will Curver, the skill development of youth players. And I never have the ambition to work with young players, but even for a senior national team or senior club team, I think it's good that you can use some of these exercises in warming up drills or even in normal training exercises to make players better. So for me, I always said as a coach, I want to improve psychological part, physical part, technical part, and then the tactical part. That are the four components. And I always want to develop as a coach. The moment you think you are, you know everything, that's the moment you go down, because football is always developing. You have to develop yourself also all the time. And that's what I try to do all the years till now. And after working in Qatar, I got the opportunity to work with Qatar in the 17 national team. And I had always that dream of working with a national team, because the time I was in Faroe Islands, I even applied. I was 28, 29, and even applied for the Fiji national team coaching job. And there was always in my mind, for me, working with a country, with a national team, representing a country is the highest you can achieve as a player, but also as a coach. And there are only 209, 210 countries. If you can work with one of them, it's the biggest honor to hear that national anthem. And when I worked with Qatar under 17, we qualified for got bronze medal in the Asian Cup in Japan, and qualified for the World Cup in Peru 2005. Mm-hmm. But I was very impatient, and I wanted to work on senior levels. I got an offer to become coach in Germany, professional club, and I went there. So step by step, I got different roles in Holland, became technical director. Bas Dost, former Sporting Lissabon, former Dutch national team player, 4 years ago, silver boot in Europe, just behind Messi with 36 goals or something. He was one of the players I coached in Emma, and I gave him his first professional contract. So I worked with some different players. Then I went to Finland, and in Finland, something strange happened. I got fired in the preseason, not knowing exactly what happened there. And 2 years later, it came out that the team was involved in match fixing. And I didn't select the players who were needed to fix games. And I knew the director of the club came frequently to me in friendlies and say, coach, you need to use this one. And I didn't listen really. I did my own thing. Yeah. And they fired me a month before the league start. And 2 years later came out that they were doing match fixing and probably I was not doing what they wanted to do. And a lot of players went to jail afterwards from that team. But it was in one way, luck in my life that I got fired before the season, because I was in Finland and I was following internet and I saw that Namibia their coach was leaving or was fired. And I called by myself, Federation of Namibia, introduced myself to the president. And 3 days later, I was national team coach of Namibia. Something I was dreaming of. I was 35. I was working already 10 years to get that idea. I knew I had applied many times, and it was very difficult to get in that circuit of national team coaches.
Yeah.
And I got a four-month deal until the end of the qualification. And I told them, after that, you tell me you're happy or not. So I took that opportunity. Namibia came out of the road that they had 11 matches or 12 matches, 11 defeats. Wow. And my first match we win, my second match we win. And before the end of the 4 months, I had a contract offer of 4 years. And my career started. And it was a fantastic experience. And just like I'm very thankful with my first club, gave me the opportunity when I was 24. Mm-hmm. I'm also thankful to the club in Faroe Islands, B71, who gave me the first opportunity to become a professional coach on senior level. And actually the opportunity that Namibia gave me as 35-year-old without any national team senior experience. Okay, I worked with under 17, but never on senior level. Yeah. And that opportunity helped me a lot. And the results were immediately there. Got several offers after a while. But at that moment, I didn't have the experience. I didn't. If you work in one country, you don't know what to expect in another country. So you always think greener pastures, other way, another side. And I was also some impatient. So after 2.5 years, I had still 2 years to go in my contract. I got several offers and I left my job in Namibia to Zimbabwe. And it was a wrong choice because in Zimbabwe, after 2 weeks, before even I ever trained, no, I had two training sessions. I had to escape out of the country because they wanted to arrest me officially because I was working without work permit, but I was the highest qualified coach in the country. I had experience. I was successful coaching Namibia. I had signed a 4-year contract with Zimbabwe and I had to run away out of the country because I had no work permit. What happened? 2 years later, it came out that Zimbabwe was involved in match fixing. And exactly the same guy as was involved in Finland was a guy called Ray Parmalan or something, a Malaysian or Singaporean guy, was involved with Zimbabwe. And a lot of people got banned in football. And again, I didn't select the players who they wanted to. I selected the previous coach selected 20 local based players and 5 foreign based players. He didn't select Benjani Morara, who played at that time for Portsmouth, I think, and he former Blackburn. No, he played for Blackburn Rovers, former Manchester City player. Mm-hmm. And when I came, I selected the best players. I selected players who play in Europe, in Austria, in Belgium, in England, Benjari, who play in South Africa. I had 5 local based players and 20 professionals from abroad. So they were not happy with my selection and they had to get rid of me before the games because they were involved in match fixing. But it happened only 2 years later, it came out. And then people forget already that I had to leave. But it was really a very bad situation in the way that I had left Namibia where I had a secure job. I was the king of Namibia. I had very good results, loved working there, beautiful country, one of the most beautiful spots on earth. And I had left it for a 4-year deal with Zimbabwe. But after 2 weeks, I was without job again. So that was really, I learned a little bit out of that. But then after that, the period came that I had to accept many short-term deals. And if you look to my CV, some people say, the coach never stay anywhere long. Mm. But sometimes people have not the knowledge of not the information was correctly. A lot of countries I worked, Malawi offered me a 3-month contract, Ethiopia, 5-month contract, Bangladesh, a 3-month contract. Because these countries have no budget for a foreign coach for a long period of time. And they said, till the end of the qualification, we can pay you. But then we have 5 months or 10 months, no games. And we don't want to spend money on a coach. So we don't want to give a 2-year contract or a 1-year contract when there are no games. Mm. So and in one way, it was negative for my CV because I got a lot of feedback from what's wrong with this coach, what's wrong with him. He never stay anywhere long. So is he bad? Did he get fired? Because people don't check if you got 3 months. I finished my contracts, 3 months. People were satisfied, 5 months, people were satisfied. But if there's no budget to pay a foreign coach, if there's no coach for 10 months after that, but on the CV, it's not written. It's not, for the people see only he stays short period. Yeah. So that was negative for my CV. But on the other side, I'm happy I did it because I became only a better coach through it. And I learned a lot because I learned a lot by working in different continents, in different countries. And as a coach, you never have to be too big to underestimate the knowledge of local people. Mm. I always work with local coaching staffs, and I always can learn from these people, learn from the culture, learn from the football culture, and we work together. I'm a team, I'm a leader, I'm a team player. I try to combine both of these things, and I always try to develop. And by working in Ethiopia, in Malawi, in Bangladesh, in Yemen, in Togo, I became a better coach. I learned a lot. I learned after mistakes I made. I learned after good choices I made. I learned from other coaches. I came in contact with different people in football, and I became the coach who I am now. And in the meantime, in 2012, I could finally follow the UEFA Pro License coach in Belgium. So after my B and A license, I got my Pro License in 2012, and I was in Ethiopia. And in that career, I had fantastic moments. I worked with fantastic players. Adebayor in Togo is one of them, but many. And in the current squad, there are so many good players. Moussa Barrow from Bologna, Omar Colley from Sampdoria, Ibrima Darbu from AS Roma. And I have so many fantastic players. I played against great coaches like Frank Rijkaard with Saudi Arabia against Yemen, with Namibia against South Africa with Carlos Alberto Pereira, former world champion. We played 1-1, so it's always nice to keep level with a world champion coach and being coach of a small country. Same with playing against Carlos Queiroz from Iran, former Portugal coach and former Real Madrid coach. Arvin Grant, when he was in Ghana, we played against him, former Chelsea coach. So it's nice to play on that level, to compete with the best. The thing is that I made a reputation of being an underdog coach. I worked many times with countries who were really losing a lot, who were lowly ranked. And the majority of my jobs, I really achieved the things I needed to achieve. I have better statistics than the coaches who were before me. Many times I have better statistics than the coaches who came after me. I changed fortunes, and sometimes very quick, immediately. And yeah, that role was really suitable. I was a few times very close to make the big step. Nigeria in 2009, I was there before the World Cup in 2010. Minister of Sport wanted me, Federation didn't want me. In 2012, I was appointed Technical Director of the Nigerian Football Federation. I was officially announced, I remember it. It was 28 March 2012. It was after we played with Ethiopia against Nigeria. Ethiopia had, that was in 2011, Ethiopia had a fully local-based team. The highest salary was $200 a month, US dollar a month. And we played Nigeria with John Obermikel, with Yobo, with Taiwo, and all the big stars, qualification match. And we were leading till the 88th minute, 2-1. And on the end, it was a free kick, and Yobo headed in 2-2. But Nigeria missed 2 points and didn't qualify for the Africa Cup because of these 2 points. And after that, Nigeria called me if I was interested to become their technical director. I had meetings. I went, spoke with Victor Ikpeba, JJ Okocha, who were there in the technical committee. They announced me 28 March, the day before my birthday. It was on BBC. It was everything agreed, 4-year deal. And 2 months later, the Minister of Sport, a new Minister of Sport, said, "I don't want a foreign guy. I want the local guy." And the local guy had a B license. I had a pro license. But I missed out of a beautiful job. And in 2016, I was one of the last three candidates to coach Nigeria for the World Cup qualification to Russia. I was with Paul Le Guin and with a local coach, Youssef. And Paul Le Guin was the first one, former Lyon coach, Glasgow Rangers coach, Cameroon and Oman coach. He refused to offer. And then I had a guarantee I would be the coach. And the new federation president put his veto against me, and the technical committee wanted me, and the president said no. So a few times I missed out of these jobs, and that's frustrating, because as a coach, my main ambition, the reason I'm national team coach, is one clear mission: is I want to go to the World Cup. I want to be on senior level World Cup as national team coach of a country. That's the reason I'm coaching national teams. Sometimes I get offers from club teams who pay much more. The North African club teams who pay crazy money, the Egyptian clubs, the Moroccan clubs, Algerian clubs, even in Europe, some clubs frequently contact me. But my dream, my ambition as a coach is never motivated by money. I need to have money to buy shoes for my wife and to survive. Let's say it like that. But my ambition is to achieve the highest, to make football countries better, to win as much as possible games, to change fortunes. And with the main aim is to qualify for a World Cup. Now I spoke a lot and you couldn't ask any questions.
I mean, this is the whole crux of this interview, I think, is I'm just I'm astounded, I think is the right word. Just like you said, the shirts in the background representing, you know, all the countries that you've managed. And it's like you've senior managed them. And it's great to just listen to your story. And you're right, you can look at your CV and you can make lots of assumptions why you've managed so many countries in so many ways. But you're right, football is like that. That's just what happens. And, you know, some of these countries in very difficult situations to have a coach that goes all the way through, you know, organizations change, different conversations happen. And as a football coach or football in any role, actually, you're sometimes the levers you can pull. You can't pull all of them and you're left out. And even though you've signed big 10-year contracts, actually that doesn't matter sometimes, even though it should be adhered to. And so, like, I think you taking us through that whole journey absolutely is the right thing to do, because people listening to this, like you said, I don't think there's many or if any coaches in the world that have the tin shirts they do behind you. And just the fact that you can get up, you can get into a country, you can work out culture, the language, the players you've got, you pick them up and you go quickly. And I think that's something that's really high up on my agenda, to go that how do you do that every time? Like, what are those first couple of things you do as you join a federation, you join a new country, that you get into place? Yeah. The first couple of tasks that you know are successful, like what are they? What do you have to do?
Yeah, first of all, let me say also, for me, you can coach one or two countries with luck, but to coach 10 countries, and by the way, there are three coaches in the world in history who coached more. Oh, that's Rudy Gutendorf. Rudy Gutendorf had 18 national teams, Otto Pfister 12, and Claude Roy 11. So I'm fourth on that list. Wow. But there are a few coach more. Rudy Gundorf, he coached several countries. I think he coached even Samoa and Fiji and these kind of countries in the past. Mm-hmm. But first thing is you don't coach so many countries if you are not able or quality to do it, because all these federations, they talk to each other. They have contact with each other. They meet each other on FIFA congresses. And you can have luck with one or two. But if you are a bad coach or a bad person, you will not get appointed again. I coach 6 African countries, 2 Asian, 1 European, 1 CONCACAF country, in total in 10. And you only get the jobs because people respect you. Even the jobs where you stay short period of time. Yemen contacted me already twice, 2019 and 2 weeks ago, to return to them. Same happened with Malawi president, who spoke very, very well about me 2 years after I left in the international media. And so people respect, and that's the reason you go back. How do you start a job in a new country or a new club? A lot of mistakes are made by a lot of coaches, and it has not only to do with a new country, a new club, because a culture of a club or a country can happen also in the country. You are living in New Zealand, and I can understand that coaching a team in Wellington is different than a team in Auckland, because the mentality of the people is different. The mentality of the club can be different. Different clubs in one city have different mentalities. So it's very important as a coach that you understand the mentality of the place you go, the country, the region, the city, the club of the federation. And you as a person, you have to adapt to that new situation. Too many coaches go, and European coaches have that problem sometimes, and they want to change everything. Mm. They think, I come from a big country, I know everything, I have this degree, I have that degree, and I'm going to change everything. Mm. First of all, it's offensive to the people who were working for many long periods in that country or that place. And secondly, there is not one truth in football. A truth is right when you get good results, but there are many ways to get there. And you can't play tiki-taka football if you don't have the players to play tiki-taka football. You can't play tiki-taka if you never have players developed to play like that. Yeah. Or you cannot play attacking football if the other team is always stronger than you and lose every game 10-0. So, and that's mistakes many times made. And I think clubs and federations sometimes appoint wrong coaches. Coaches who have the nice story, I'm going to play like Manchester City, I'm going to play like this, I'm going to play like that. But is it realistic? Is it suitable for the team you are coaching, the club team or the national team you're coaching? So first of all, you have to know the place where you go, the culture, the mentality, the religion sometimes. And you have to respect that and you have to adapt to that. One thing I do, for instance, if I get, imagine I'm free and I get today a phone call of a place, let's say Vanuatu call me and say, please come tomorrow to us and next week you have first friendly, because that happens. That happens with club teams, that happens with national teams, that I had to travel the other side of the world and that I had a week or two later already my first match when I would never visit the game. So what I do is I learn every player and every staff member, their names, their positions, with their pictures. So if I get a phone call today and tomorrow I arrive, the moment I arrive, I know everyone by name, by face, and their history. So I want to arrive and be able to say, hey, Alistair, how are you? You play that position, you play there. But for me, that's very important. You have to be well prepared as a coach when you start a new job. You have to know where you arrive. You know every player by face, by name, his position. And we talk now about countries you never were. I mean, if you move in New Zealand from one club to the other, naturally, you know all the top league players. Yeah. But if you move from New Zealand tomorrow to South Sudan, you probably never knew a player of South Sudan. But the moment you arrive, you know every player by name, which club he plays, which position he plays, and you know his face, you recognize him. Same with board members, same with staff members. That shows a lot of respect and dedication from you to them. Then the next thing is try as a coach not to start with the aim, I'm going to change everything. Try to listen. Try to listen to the people from, hey, how do you experience the previous coaches? What went wrong in your eyes? What is the habits? What is the culture of playing football here? How did they get the best results in the past? When I was technical director in Holland of FC Emmen, first division in Holland, second highest league, they had a good history of Scandinavian players. Former Finnish captain Mika Nurmela played there, some Danish players played there. That was more than 10 years before I came there. But I thought by myself, if these players adapt good, then I have to find these such similar players on that market. Within Holland, there were players who come from Amsterdam. It's 200 kilometers away from the place I worked. But Amsterdam and Emmen is a total different culture, total different mentality. Emmen has 110,000 people, a little bit small farmer town. Amsterdam, a world city with bars, discos. A lot of these players didn't stay at night in Emmen. They drove every day up and down, 200 kilometers one way, 200 kilometers back way. So they were not focused. They were not integrated. And the Scandinavian players who played in the past, they had similar mentality with the club and with the region. And they felt well and they developed. They made transfers to Heerenveen, to Kaiserslautern, from these kind of clubs. So sometimes close by doesn't mean that it's more suitable. You have to find players in a club team who adapt in your club structure, in your region. Mm-hmm. And a lot of transfers are wrong made, even internationally on the highest platform. You can be a very good player for Leicester City, but not good for Manchester United or Manchester City. You can win the championship of the league in England with Leicester, but not win the league with Manchester City or Chelsea, because it's a different culture, a different kind of pressure, a different kind of mentality of what is demanded. And as a coach, as a manager, as a player, as a director, you have to understand that and analyze things. You have to analyze history to know how future can be. And for me, that's very important, to be very well prepared every task. So when I get a task, I had several club tasks, I had several federation, national team tasks. I try to be top prepared before I start my task. Prepared about the country, not only football, but also the history, colonization, religion, culture, habits, history of the club or the federation, results, past results, past coaches, players, and the current situation. What was going on the weeks, the months before I arrived, and what could be the future? What are the local league qualities? Where are the players? To know everything. The moment you know, you need to have so much information in your mind, because then you are also stronger. You will be not so easy surprised in the new situation. You have more time to listen to people because you have already a lot of information and you can make new clusters and say, okay, that I know, that can be useful, that cannot be useful. And then step by step, you're going to introduce your own philosophy. So step by step, you don't go like an hurricane and change everything, a tornado, and destroy a lot of things. No, you go step by step. You say, okay, this is good, what we have, but now let's improve this. Let's improve that step by step. And if you do that step by step, people are eager to follow you. If you change everything in a tornado, then people say, hey, why he doesn't respect us? Why he want to change everything? So that's very important. And always working with the local people, listening to the local people. In Gambia now, also in every country, I have local assistant coaches, local team managers, and always in communication with them, always consulting them. I'm the boss. I take the decision that I'm responsible. If it goes wrong, my hat goes off. Yeah. But I consult people. I will consult their opinion. Also during games, before I make changes, I will ask, hey, what do you think about this? Even 30 minutes before, I have already something in mind. I tell, hey, what do you think about it? Please consider it and give your feedback. And I like people who give their feedback. We don't have to agree about things. If I don't agree with you, I will ask, hey, but why you say this? And maybe you have a good explanation for it. And I say, hey, perfect. You see it better than me. For me, it doesn't matter how we win. If it's with my idea or the idea of the bus driver, I don't care. But I want to win. I want to win every match I compete. Yeah. I hate losing. And you can only win if you work as a team. There is not one individual person who win trophies. Yeah. Coaches who think that they win trophies by themselves, they will fail. And it's a team. It's a team of your technical team. It's a team around you. It's all the players who do it. Mm-hmm. And you have to work. And as a coach, you're responsible. You have to be a good example. You have to show the right way. You have to take decisions, because mm-hmm. sometimes there is no agreement. Sometimes you don't agree with things. And still, as coach, you have to consider what is then the right decision. And you are responsible for that. But it's always teamwork. And for me, being well prepared, every decision well considered, and knowing that you check all options, makes you also stronger to your players. Mm-hmm. Because if I talk to a group of players, knowing that what decision we take, how we're going to play, what tactical decision or which selection decision is based not on emotion, not on the feeling of the day, but really on decisions based on football that can be technical, tactical, physical, or mental, then the decision is also stronger to defend. And if you get them questions, if they say, but coach, why? You are not scared to respond to that. Also to your federation, also to the media. I love press conferences. I know some coaches are scared of press conferences. I love press conferences because in a press conference, I decide what I answer. And as a coach, you never please everyone. You will make decisions. You will select people who other people don't like. You will not select people who people think they have to be selected. But people base their selection sometimes on football qualities, but sometimes also on personal things. Sometimes friends, same region, same background, a type of player they like. But maybe the player doesn't fit in the tactical strategy of a coach. You can be a very good striker, but a good striker in a two-striker system and not in a one-striker system, or a different way. You can be a very good wingback, but very offensive, and I want a defensive wingback. So there are a lot of things what makes decisions that you take these decisions, but you have to consider them. And you have to know exactly from, I do this for this reason. And when you get questions from your board, from players, from your staff, from media, you know, and you don't have to explain everything all the time, but at least you know why you took decisions, and you certain things you can explain. And I think being well prepared for yourself as coach always developing yourself, but also specific to the situation, to the country, to the culture, is the most important when you start a new task.
I think, yeah, you mentioned a few times there that you're incorporating everyone else's ideas into the overarching outcome of what you want to get out of a situation, a moment of play, a decision behind the scenes. Is you're right, yes, you're the ultimate decision maker, but actually getting the thoughts and the understandings and discussions of people around you, whether it's a healthy discussion, whether it's an agreement, whether it's actually, well, we'll agree to disagree, it's okay, because you're opening up, you know, a Pandora's box of that situation, you understand, and then you make one decision, and you have to make one decision to go either way, and whether it's wrong. And I suppose that also leads into the press conferences, is the whole country is listening to you, your staff, your management, your players, and you're kind of leading the press into certain pathways to go, I'm going to tell you some information, but not others, because I don't need to tell you, but I'm actually telling the world those ideas. Those ideas that I spoke to my staff about, I'm going to like portray in this other way. And people are excellent. Wow. We were along on that journey with my coach. I'm really fired up, and I'm behind this team now. So you can kind of use that to your advantage to have it as a common good, rather than just, yeah, that one person and everyone else don't really care about your decisions and your ideas.
Cause I've been exactly. And imagine during a match or in the hotel before a match, and I think I want to use player A, and my four or five other staff members say, we think it's player B better. First of all, I will say, guys, why you think that? And if there comes a very good explanation, it's not because I'm the head coach that I have to follow my way. If everyone else think a different way, probably they are right. Yeah. So it for me, it's very important to consult people to grow in it. And I have to say, as a young coach, when I started 24 till 30, it didn't happen so much. I was more the decision-taking coach. Also, I wanted to do everything myself, from warming up till everything. By getting more experience, more pedigree maybe, you're also easier to give things out of your hands. Let people from your coaching staff do warming ups. I have physical coaches around me, work with video analysts, let him do the analysis. So give things out of your hands. You are still the manager, you are the people manager, you are the coordinator, and finally you are responsible, but you give things out of your hands. You delegate people, you give responsibilities away, and you get more a team where everyone is involved and everyone has a role to play. And I think that's also a strength. At the beginning, coach is very difficult, because you want to control everything, and you don't know who you can trust, and you think you know everything the best as a beginning coach. That's normal. But when you grow, to be standing on the football pitch with my coaching staff and seeing people doing the job like I want to see it, and I'm looking and observing, I get more time to analyze things, to analyze my players, to consider tactical decisions I will make before a match or after the match. So it is really, but it's something you grow. I don't believe that you are the coach you were 5 years ago, or you will be the coach in 5 years the same. If you are still the same coach, I think something went wrong. I think as a human being, you change, and as a coach, you need to change also. You have to grow and learn from mistakes and learn from others.
That's right. And of course, the game changes as well, right? So you could also always be the same coach, the same techniques, or have the same staff around you. But as you know, the game changes every, you know, 3-5 years, and you've got to kind of keep up with that at the same time. So you might have nailed it 1 year, and then, I mean, it's the same with any club that goes and wins the Premier League of their country. It's very rare that they'll keep going and going and going again, because things change, you know? And so, and I suppose even at a country level,
always refreshing ideas and keeping up. And because if you don't refresh, if you don't keep up, the rest will do and you will drop. So very important. But sometimes it's difficult. After a success, people sometimes, I try always to be the same guy. We qualified now Gambia. When I took over Gambia was 172 in the world. Gambia never qualified for the African Cup. Gambia had won one match in the 5 years before I arrived, between 2013, 2018. Now we last 3 years we won 10 games, 5 draws. We qualified for the first time, first in history, away competitive away victory. We played twice Algeria. We drew. We won against Morocco, the likes of Ziyech against Algeria, Mahrez, and all the guys. So we are very competitive. But I always want to be. You get respected and you get some awards. But I won't be always the same guy.
Yeah.
I mean, tomorrow I can lose again. Tomorrow I can fail again. Yeah. And you have to be always humble. And I think that's also very important to be critical to yourself, staying humble. You can enjoy the success you have, but you know that sooner or later you will have also disappointment.
Yeah.
And there will be a failure. There are two kinds of coaches who are fired and coaches who will be fired. So you have to be realistic in that. You don't have to go too much thinking now I'm the best in the world, because then you can fall deep and you have to be always staying normal.
That's right. So last question for you, Tom, what does the future hold for you? I mean, obviously COVID's not ideal for anyone in any kind of sport. Hopefully as the year progresses next year, it might change, but what's it like for you? And what are you looking forward to in the next wee while?
Yeah, I extended my contract with Gambia for till 2026 World Cup.
Wow.
So we qualified now for the Africa Cup for the first time in history. But I, since my arrival, 31 players made their debut. I have a lot of 18, 19, 20-year-old players. A lot of boys went to Europe. Gambia is the smallest country on the African continent. It's smaller than Lesotho, smaller than Eswatini, former Swaziland. So it's a very small country, but a football-loving country. I have very good federation, very supportive, good players, good staff. So it's really very enjoyable to work there. I feel really good. I'm working already 3 years there. So that's a clear sign, and the results are there. So I'm building further. I'm staying at the moment in Europe, also because more than 100 Gambian players play currently in Europe. I have players in AS Rome, in Sampdoria, Bologna, Hellas Verona, Atalanta Bergamo, Zurich, Granada, Molde, Salzburg in Sweden, Östersund. So all over Europe, they are spread. Some also in Africa, some also in Asia. But we have really a talented group, and I want to develop it. In January, we will play our maiden Africa Cup in Cameroon. We don't know yet against who we will play. That will be beginning August, will be the draw. So we are really looking forward to that. And we played the last 3 years against the likes of Guinea, Gabon, Angola, Congo. I mentioned already Algeria, Morocco, and we could beat them or play a draw against them. So we were never under their level. So we are really looking forward to that AFCON to see how good are we, how far can we reach, because you never played on that level with the team, so you don't know what will happen. And after that, the 2023 AFCON will come, and so we will preparing. Sadly enough, we are not in the World Cup qualification for Qatar. In 2019, because we were so bad ranked in the FIFA ranking, we had to play playoffs. We lost against Angola in one playoff match, and we were out already of the qualification. Very, very stupid. Even for the Africa Cup, we are the first ever pre-qualifier team qualified for the Africa Cup. We were ranked in the 8 worst African countries. So we had to play playoff matches against Djibouti. And from there out, we came in the group stage as the worst ranked team. But we won our group before Gabon, before Congo, and before Gabon with Aubameyang, Congo with a lot of European top players, and Angola. So we will develop the team, and I'm really looking forward to that. And I hope that the COVID situation changes, because before COVID, I was always in Italy, in Norway, in Sweden, in Spain, to watch players, to watch games. It helps me also to meet my players, to see them in their environment, but also to learn from the other coaches, to see more strategies and everything. So I hope I can travel soon again. Yeah. We will have friendlies the coming months. And I'm really very happy with the support I get in the federation. I can compare a lot of federations, but from the board to my staff, team manager, my players, but everyone around also. It's really a pleasure to work there. But my main aim, and then we come to the end, is going to the World Cup. And the aim is in 2026 to be there with Gambia. We believe it could be possible because we have a very young squad. If we can develop the team the next 4 or 5 years, the players can be stronger. plus at the moment five African countries will go to the World Cup. I think the 2026 World Cup will be held in Mexico, United States and Canada. There will be nine African countries going, so the chances get bigger to be part of that. So we will see. And as a coach, I worked in so many countries. I still have the dream to work in Oceania. I would love to guide a country like New Zealand, but also other nations to World Cup, because I believe that in Oceania it's possible. Now it's only one of half a team who will go, but in the future it will be probably two teams to go. And I really believe it's possible. And my strength, I think, is I guided so many countries who were underdog positions. And almost in every country, I achieved a goal. So almost in every country, I made surprising results against nations no one expected. And if New Zealand or Vanuatu or Tahiti or New Caledonia or Samoa or Fiji or any country in the region would reach that far that they have to play playoff against a team from Latin America or something like that, I believe then you need a different mindset of coaching. Because as New Zealand, you are the best in the region or probably the best. And it's a different way of playing. When you come against better teams, you need a different strategy. You need to play totally different football. And if New Zealand or any other country in Oceania would reach ever the World Cup, you need a different strategy. You are not anymore the best. You are now the underdog. And that is also one of my strengths. And that was, for instance, what people in Nigeria liked about me. The ones who appointed me was that I believe that a country like Nigeria, but also Cameroon, Ivory Coast, these kind of countries, Ghana, could become world champion. If you look to the quality of players they have, the leagues they play in the world, they have top players. But the moment you reach a world championship, you're not anymore the best of Africa. You are one of the teams who play World Cup, and you will play Argentina, you will play Italy or Belgium or Brazil. And then you need a different philosophy. You need to play different football. And for me, it's the first place. The only thing what counts in football is winning. And sure, you want to develop. But when you play on senior level as a club coach or as a national team coach, the first thing what counts is to win. And you have to do everything for that. The strategy is the strategy and the way of playing is secondary to the result. And I always tell my people, because working in Africa, sometimes people want to play very nice football. They like the tiki-taka football. I said, yes, we can play tiki-taka football. You played, yes, tiki-taka football, and you lost almost all the games. Yeah. So you can play good football and be celebrated for 90 minutes. Or you can play organized football, result-orientated football, and be celebrated for the rest of your life. Yeah. And that's something I don't want to be the best in the world, but I want to be world champion. Mm. And that's something you have to think about. You can be the best. Belgium is number one on the FIFA ranking. Belgium, everyone expected, they were hoping the Belgians for sure to become European champion, but they were kicked out very early. Yes. So it doesn't matter how you play, the way is to win and to get results. And I hope to develop my philosophy, my strategies as a coach, to grow as a coach. I'm really looking forward to my future with Gambian football. And after that, naturally, I would love to coach different countries, try to achieve my dream to go to a World Cup and to experience more.